This is Talk of the Nation. I'm Neil Conan in Washington. Longtime ad man Tom Burrell argues that the longest-running, most successful propaganda campaign of all time is for black inferiority, from posters that advertised slaves for sale to The New Yorker's Radical Obama's cover, unrelenting, powerfully persuasive efforts to promote what he calls the brand of black inferiority. Even today, for every positive image of African Americans, he finds 100 negative stereotypes, too many of them perpetrated by blacks themselves. After more than 4 decades in the ad game and induction into the Advertising Hall of Fame, Tom Burrell founded the Resolution Project, a nonprofit that promotes community-based media campaigns, and he has a new book out. So Tom Burrell is with us from the studios of Chicago Public Radio, founder and former CEO of Burrell Communications, and the author of Brainwashed, Challenging the Myth of Black Inferiority. And it's nice to have you with us today.
It's great to be here.
And your book is both a descriptive and prescriptive, and we'll get to that second part in a bit. But you bring special expertise, I think, on the imagery. I did not know, for example, that slave auction posters are amongst the earliest ads in American history.
Well, you know, advertising came in many, many forms, including any form of communication such as the Bible, text, posters, placards. And we could even consider the caricatures of African Americans and salt and pepper shakers and banks as a part of advertising. They're basically images and words. They're very powerful. Images and words are very powerful, and they conveyed and carried out this whole idea of African Americans being less than, not as good as, the myth of black inferiority.
And the concomitant myth of white superiority.
And the concomitant myth. We were all sold a bill of goods. The myth of black inferiority. That was a myth that had to be created in order to justify slavery within a democracy. These two contradictions had to be reconciled, and the only way that they could come up with to reconcile it was to declare and then substantiate that these slaves were not human. So then you could say all men are created equal and move ahead.
A paradox contained in the single individual of Thomas Jefferson.
Absolutely. Absolutely. You know, he said all men are created equal, and then he said Africans, by their very nature, are inferior to whites.
And I wanted to ask, we're asking our listeners to say, how did this play out in your life? And growing up there in Chicago, how did this play out in your life?
Well, I grew up in the era of the New Deal.
Mm-hmm.
And we were very much subjected to learned helplessness. I mean, the idea of our inferiority was played out constantly by reinforcing the thought that we could not take care of ourselves. And that was played out in the media as we grew up. As I grew up with characters in movies who were buffoons, characters on the radio, whether they be Beulah or Amos and Andy, who were basically servants and clowns. We didn't see ourselves portrayed in a positive and powerful way growing up. And we basically heard that we were not as good as white people.
But was there a moment for you when you said, hey, wait a minute, when did the light dawn?
Well, I have to say that the images have been so powerful, I was probably 40 years old before I realized that the whole thing was a sham. You know, what you do is you kind of fake it till you make it, and you think, well, maybe either I'm the exception to the rule, or you think that, well, maybe I'm not as good or as smart as people think that I am, and maybe I'll just keep trying to fool them. Then it dawns on you at some point in your life, perhaps if you're lucky, that, wait a minute, this is a myth. All of the images that I've been fed, all of the concepts that I have been taught to accept are false. It's false advertising.
And by that time, you'd been in the advertising business for a while.
I'd been in the advertising business for almost 20 years. And, you know, the whole thing is that both for blacks and whites, this whole myth is internalized, and some people live with it for their whole lives.
There were any number of, let me ask you specifically, in those first 20 years before the light dawned, are there, looking back on it, any ads that, you'd regret in retrospect?
That we created?
Yeah.
Well, we were very fortunate that when I started the company in 1971, halfway through my career, we were assigned to the African-American consumer market. So I basically had to study the African consumer market. So what we did that was totally unique coming out of the Black Power movement of the late 60s, which sprung out of the Civil Rights movement, mm-hmm. is we concentrated on what we call positive realism. I had come up with the phrase, black people are not dark-skinned white people. And that was related to the idea that we came to this country in a way totally different from any other group, against our will and into servitude and into vilification and enslavement. Mm-hmm. And that shaped a lot of how we behave as consumers.
Give me a for instance.
A for instance is we spend an inordinate amount of money of the money that we make on goods and services, primarily goods that we really don't have to have. Mm-hmm. And goods that are usually depreciated from the time that we get it. They start depreciating, especially automobiles.
Oh, so high-end automobiles or things like that.
Yeah, you ask the question, well, why is it that we spend everything that we have on things that aren't going to appreciate for us? And the answer lies in the fact that when we came to this country, we were stripped of everything. We were stripped of our name, of our origin, of our language, of our religion. We lost contact with our families. We had nothing. And we lost our status as human beings because we came here and were deemed to be property, less than human. We were put on the auction block and we were sold like cattle, okay? So in our attempt in a materialistic capitalistic society to gain somebodiness, what do? In a materialistic society, we try to do it through getting stuff and owning stuff. And it's not a matter of buying things that we can't show off. It's all about things that we can show off that basically are saying, hey, look at me, world. Mm-hmm. I am somebody.
Some people might point out that emancipation happened in 1865. The great civil rights legislation of 1965 ended the era of Jim Crow, at least illegally. Things have changed a lot. Yet you say the stain of that experience in slavery continues many generations later.
What we have to understand is that we aren't talking about ancient history. You know, we have slave narratives that were written in 1933, people who lived in slavery. So this whole idea that we're talking about ancient history, we're talking about a few generations ago. And these traditions, this inferiority that was drummed into us through the media, through propaganda, has passed down from generation to generation just like a favorite family recipe. So we haven't, you know, if you don't address issues, if you have a cancer, if you have a tumor, you can't just wait for it to dissipate. It doesn't just go away. It gets passed down. And you have this illusion of progress, you know, or even a delusion of progress that just doesn't take away the fact that after all of the efforts that have been made, we are still, as a people, at the top of just about every bad list.
In terms
and
of
at the bottom of just education, income, incarceration, out of wedlock, childbirth, teen pregnancies, HIV, childhood obesity, infant mortality. I mean, just go through the list. And so you say, well, why is that? Well, it's because of the fact that we bought into the fact of the myth of black inferiority, And everybody else bought into that as well, as well as the myth of white superiority.
Let's get some listeners in on the conversation. 800-989-8255. Email us talk at npr.org. James on the line calling from San Antonio.
Yes, I'm about 26 years old, and I remember even as a kid, for me, most of in media, specifically TV and film, I mean, you have things like the Kenan and Kel show and the Fat Albert remake and Family Matters. And I agree with the gentleman that it seems like most of the black figures are kind of dumb or outrageous or buffoonery. And Tyler Perry, you know, it's not politically correct to say, but I see the same thing there. And you sometimes have to look to white shows if they decide to include black folks at all. They're a little bit more not cartoon characters. And
well, maybe you were too young, but the Cosby Show certainly portrayed a different image.
Yes, the Cosby Show, and that was a show run by. I wonder if some of these shows are run by white executives and trying to show something that maybe white people in Hollywood think blacks are. That's all I wanted to say.
Right. I think Bill Cosby ran that show. But anyway, James,
that's
thanks
right.
very
Bill
much.
Bill Cosby did run that show. And that's why it came out the way that it came out. Very positive, you know.
We're talking about the myth of black inferiority. Tom's Burrell's book is titled Brainwashed. More of your calls in a moment. Let's see if we can go next to Patricia. Patricia calling from Walnut Creek in California.
Yes, hi.
Hi.
I love this. This show really makes my head think. I need to think about this. Because, Mr. Burrell, I think I'm brainwashed. I'm 55 years old, and I'm a product of a military family. I was raised in, born in St. Louis, raised in Fairbanks, Alaska, and in San Antonio, Texas. And as I grew up, the images that I saw were very, I mean, I was totally embarrassed, totally angry. You know, forgive me, buckwheat, step and fetchy, I couldn't stand any of that. So I think I need to read your book, because what happens for me when I see Tyler Perry and Madea, They make me laugh. I you know, my mother's 84 and a product of the Mississippi segregation. She enjoys him, you know, immensely. Mm-hmm. And I'm thinking the show today is really is going to be part of my discussion today at lunch with my girlfriends as we talk about this, because this is troubling if indeed it's true that, you know, these are images that are self-destructive to us. Mm-hmm. I mean, I love the Cosby Show, but then when I was growing up too, I mean, we never saw any blacks on TV that used hair products or brushed their teeth. And when they finally did in the 1970s, we were so excited.
Right.
I think by the time Good Times came around, what is it, the one with the bigot? I can't remember his name right now.
Oh, Archie Bunker? Archie Barker, All in the Family,
All in the Family. We were excited to see black folk on the TV. We were excited about that. So now I think we've come full circle from this. And like I said, Mr. Burrell, I might have to read your book. Because either we're missing the boat or not. I mean, I love Tyler Perry. I love his movies. I support them. I have in the past. So what am I doing?
Well, I hope you don't mind if I agree with you that you may be brainwashed.
Yeah, probably.
Here's the deal about brainwashing. What brainwashing does, and, you know, I'm speaking as a person who was in that business for 45 years, what that brainwashing does is get you to a point of being so insensitive to, or desensitized that you become unconscious to what is going into your head and what you're seeing and what you're hearing.
Okay.
You also become a party to the brainwashing, or black people become a party to the brainwashing. That's the nature of brainwashing. That you join in and become your own victimizer. So what has happened is that you have bought into this whole idea of it being harmless.
Yes.
And it is not harmless, because what it is reinforcing all of those negative things that you get back when you were watching Step and Fetch It. But if you look at it objectively, you see very little difference between Step and Fetch It, Mantan Moreland,
yes,
and then Tracy Morgan
and Jemima,
you know,
Uncle Tracy, Black Sambo. I hate it.
Yeah, but moving forward to Tracy Morgan, Tyler Perry, and the rest, the Medea character, and so
right.
forth. It's a straight line.
Yeah.
It's just that it's put in a different kind of context that gives it a kind of air respectability.
Yeah.
And as you point out in your book, this is done by Black entrepreneurs with Black people behind the camera, Black people writing the script, and
right.
African Americans running the company.
And then we buy it. You know, we. And what it is that we are more capable of carrying out or executing this than the people who basically indoctrinated us to do it in the first place.
Hmm.
You know, it has more credibility once we grab it. And you know, like, for instance, we have a chapter called Neocoons that talks about comedy.
Mm-hmm.
You know, in the old days when we started, you had white comedians putting on black cork and basically humiliating and ridiculing black people.
Yeah.
Fast forward, you get this thing called progress. Then black comedians came in and says, hey, you guys don't have to do that. We'll do it.
Hmm.
We'll take it over. And they have taken it over to the point where, like in the use of the N-word, for instance, white people can't even begin to say it as fast as we can say it and with such conviction. And we own it as if we are being empowered by it, when in fact what we're doing is we're continuing to damage ourselves with it.
Patricia?
Because if...
Patricia,
yes.
I just wanted to say thank you very much for the phone call.
Oh, I appreciate
thank
the
you.
Candor.
We wish we could
thank
go to lunch
you.
With
thank
you today.
Patricia.
It sounds like it's
yeah,
going right. to be an interesting
yeah,
time.
Right.
Let's see, we go next to, this is Denise. Denise calling from St. Paul.
Hi, this topic really touches a nerve. I have to tell you, the question of capability and your guest, Mr. Burrell, is absolutely on point. I mean, we only have to look nationally at what has happened with the president's social secretary, Desiree Rogers,
mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
questioning of her abilities and her subsequent stepping down. I worked for a company and reported to a white woman who constantly questioned my right to be in the company. She would look at my work, which in comparison to my colleagues, I felt I was on par, but she often questioned in a way that wasn't direct, but she would say, well, you just don't quite fit. You're not like the others. And it completely undermined my confidence. And, of course, in most organizations, there aren't the systems for black people, support systems for black people to go and have an honest conversation and say, mm-hmm. you know, what is going on here?
Would you say, Tom Burrell, that in this situation she's describing, basically both people had been brainwashed?
Absolutely. Absolutely. You know, both people basically have been brainwashed, and it gets to a point where people become accustomed to where they are. You know, Carter G. Woodson, a famous black historian, talked about the idea that African Americans have been basically conditioned to go around to the back door. And if there is no back door, we will insist on one.
Hmm.
Whites, on the other hand, are comforted by this whole notion of white supremacy, especially given the fact that there is some fear factor there as well, because underneath there is this feeling that maybe their ancestors did something wrong. So they look for reassurance that they're okay. And if you can get a black comedian to show up on a late night talk show and just act a clown, it's comforting to those people. Say, you know, yeah, they are a happy people. You know, they're okay. You know, it's just like going up to a dog and saying, boy, you know, I hope it doesn't bite. You know, and if it starts wagging its tail, you know, you feel, oh, that's great. I love it. You know,
yeah.
So It is a perfect kind of toxic mix, the idea of white supremacy white superiority and black inferiority. It kind of goes together, and people get comfortable in their roles, and they accept their roles.
Denise, we wish you the best of luck. Thanks very much for the phone call.
Thank you.
Here's an email we have from Kate in Portland, Oregon. I was struck 40 years ago with this issue when I was in high school. I knew a young black man who wanted to be a doctor. His parents could not afford to send him to the school he wanted to go to for pre-med, so he was focused on getting a scholarship. That meant a 4.0 GPA, National Honor Society, a host of extracurricular activities. What impressed me was that at 15, he was able to accept the rejection and derision of his peers for, quote, trying to be white, unquote, and pursued his dream in the face of it. I was disturbed that he had to make that choice at all.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, we have a chapter called D's Will Do. Why do we expect so little of ourselves and each other? And there are several reasons why that happens. I mean, there is lower expectations means fewer disappointments. You know, if you are taught that blacks are inferior, then you set up your own substrata for performance. The other thing is that you basically become comfortable with negative behavior. So then being smart gets interpreted as acting white. Because to be smart is also to be different. And to be different means that you're trying to be better than we are, those who aren't striving. So, I mean, there have been cases. I mean, I had my own situation when I was in grade school. I was doing pretty well in fourth grade. But I saw myself being moved away from my peers who were basically into the D's will do category. And they basically started to reject me. So I had to dumb down in order to fit in. And we get that phenomenon going on all the time. What we want to do is we want to change that model so that being smart becomes acting black. You know, that's what we have to do to overcompensate for what has been in existence.
I did want to ask you about one thing in the book. You wrote that the only comparable campaign of inferiority was that waged by the Nazis against the Jews in the 30s and 40s. And you said, but that was only 12 years.
And that's being liberal, being 12 years, because some people would argue that it was 4 years.
And some people would argue it was 2,000 years, that the pogroms go way back and that this is not new. And why did you feel the need to say ours is the worst ever when the Jews and the Irish and the Kurds and the Palestinians, any number of groups, would pick a fight with you?
Well, I'm talking about the fact that we're talking about one country, basically, and we're talking about a particular form of slavery called American chattel slavery. It didn't exist anywhere else because there was no democracy anywhere else. It wasn't the slavery that was the main problem. It was the need to justify it by building up the myth. So that after the slavery was abolished and the chains were removed, the psychological chains remained. But getting back to the idea of I'm not into a contest to see who's suffered the most pain. The only thing that I wanted to do is put American chattel slavery into some kind of perspective. The comparative is that we're not talking about slavery and Jews. We're talking about Hitler. We're talking about Nazism and Jews versus America and blacks.
Different, but not necessarily worse or better. Anyway, the book is called Brainwashed, Challenging the Myth of Black Inferiority. You're listening to Talk of the Nation from NPR News. Author Tom Burrell is with us from Chicago, and let's see if we can go next to Shadiqua in Tallahassee.
Thanks, Neil. How are you doing?
I'm well, thank you.
I have. I wanted to ask the caller about what to do with our young black children today. I'm in an interracial relationship. My first son isn't, he's all black. But in any event, a lot of people are calling him out the 40s and the 50s, and I want to know what can we do about right now. For instance, one day we were there, 8 and 9, and we were on our way to the dentist's office, And my stepson, he said, his father is white, that's what I'm with now. He said, well, is the dentist going to be white or black? And my son said, oh, no, he's going to be white. I mean, if he was going to be black, he'd be like a rapper or a basketball player or something. So it was time to turn off the radio.
And right? That's when we get to the prescriptive part of your book. Go ahead, Tom Burrell.
Yeah. But before the prescriptive part, you have to understand that it is the media that is feeding that information to these young kids. It's in the form of lyrics. It's in the form of images and the video games that feed into that. Now, as far as the prescriptive is concerned, we have a wonderful opportunity now to turn around these 300 years of negative images into positive images with one weapon, and that is a library card.
We go to the library. I have doctors in my family. I have lawyers in my family. And I tell them that all the time. That's one of the reasons why we can't watch a lot of television. I tell them that, of course.
Right.
But I don't know if it was this program that Neil's had. Another program was talking exactly that the media, like, I'm just one voice, if you will, in these 24/7 images that they have.
Mm-hmm. Right. Right. And what we've got to do is we've got to turn those images around. We have got to start to come together. We have a chapter also on unity, how we've been taught in the concept of individualism instead of collective thinking, gathering as a collective mass. And we have got to say we aren't going to take that from our kids. If you read the book, you will not go away you'll be much more conscious of the cues that your kids are getting every day, reinforcing this whole idea. Because I'm afraid that there are some things that are getting into his head that you're not necessarily seeing, because they get so subtle. But anyway, the antidote is the new technology where you can have a movie studio in your computer. And you can have a recording studio in your computer, and we can use the creativity that has caused us to survive all these centuries to start creating positive images to offset the negative ones. We can also, through StopTheBrainwash.com, which we have set up, set up a watchdog kind of coming together where we can basically point out those culprits, point out those instances where we are being fed toxic material, and discuss it.
But even a family member makes it hard for us, because, like, one of my children can't really watch too much Disney, even Hannah Montana. It's not many black people in there, and when they are, they're being, you know, they're servers or whatever. And my mom and other family members are like, it's no harm in that. You're too this, you're too that. How can you be so pro-black and you're in an interracial relationship? And you know, like, even family members think I go overboard when I don't let them watch, you know, television that if there's not a black man that has a reputable position on that show.
I hope you can get him to read the book.
Okay, Sadiq, well, we wish you the best of luck. It sounds like you're up against it. But good luck to you. Thanks for the phone call. And Tom Burrell, thanks very much for your time today.
Thank you.
Tom Burrell's book is...